to Disney Odd Pod.
I'm Kat.
I'm Dee.
And this week, the wonderful love story about hopes and dreams, but we just want the New Orleans food references!
Princess and the Frog from 2009.
Everyone thinks they know the story of the Princess and the Frog, but no one knows what happened after the kiss. In the tradition of Walt Disney's most beloved classics, comes the story behind the most magical kiss the world has ever known.
I'm just saying, I just want more of the Charlotte chick force-feeding her dad beignets. That might have been my favorite part of the movie.
I like every part with Charlotte in it.
Because she's hilarious.
Yeah, she's very...
Spoiler, a little disappointed there wasn't more of her in the movie.
I agree.
She's really funny.
Yeah. See, because my favorite part was her in the cafe.
That's what I mean. At the beginning, when she's, like, force-feeding her dad and interrupting...
Lottie in cafe.
Yeah, so what did you think about this movie?
It's a very good movie. It's a very heartfelt, nice movie with a ton of songs.
A ton of great songs.
Holy Randy Newman.
So, I actually, like, the first time I saw this movie, I just kind of was, eh. But I just think maybe I wasn't in the right headspace, I guess, to where I didn't appreciate New Orleans like I do now, maybe. But
it definitely helps if you've been to New Orleans to watch this movie. It's a very American movie, which is great.
Yeah, and that's what their kind of goal was, to make an American movie. Oh, we gotta set it in New Orleans.
An American fairy tale, yeah.
It's also kind of interesting, because this movie, if you look at all the animated movies that were made after it, it was kind of the beginning of the modern Disney renaissance that we're kind of in right now, because you had this one, Tangled, Frozen, Zootopia, Moana.
Yeah, okay, I can see that.
And the 90s was Little Mermaid, Beauty and the Beast, Aladdin, Lion King, and Pocahontas.
And then we had the middling movies
in and between. It's kind of a very similar kind of pattern, actually.
Well, and these guys did have a part in all of those movies.
That's what I'm saying. It's all connected.
Yeah.
Go straight to the top! Let me read this synopsis really quick. This is obviously on Disney Plus. It would be strange if it wasn't. Princess and the Frog from 2009. Family, comedy, fantasy, animation, musical. A modern twist on a classic fairy tale from Walt Disney. Animation Studios features a beautiful girl named Tiana who dreams of owning her own restaurant. When she meets a frog prince who desperately wants to be human again, a fateful kiss leads them both on a hilarious adventure through the mystical bayous of Louisiana, with the villainous voodoo magician Dr. Falsier is in hot pursuit.
You know, that was actually one of the worst parts of the movie, is that Dr. Falsier's name was Dr. Falsier.
It was, because you only really caught it in the very beginning, and then
they call him the Shadow Man. That they just needed a good name for him, just like one name.
He was a good villain.
He was a great villain.
I actually really enjoyed his little tiny song, too, quite a bit.
Yeah.
I really enjoyed a lot of things about this movie.
Yeah, it was very enjoyable.
The boys are back in town.
Yeah, oh, you're talking about our writers and directors, Ron Clements and John Muster?
Yeah, with tag-along writer Greg Erb, who, spoiler alert, wrote on Rocket Man.
Yeah, he wrote the great comedy masterpiece. Rocket Man.
No! God, please, no! No!
Maybe that's why there were those few fart jokes in here. He's like, that's my joke.
That's me.
Remember in Rocket Man when it was so funny, all the farting?
So yeah, we know they did all these movies like Moana and Hercules and Aladdin and Little Mermaid and all this stuff.
And don't forget about Treasure Planet. Forget about Treasure Planet.
Always do forget about
underrated movie, Treasure Planet.
Very forgettable.
Shh, forgot a lot about it. Sorry, what's that guy's name again?
Who?
From Treasure Planet?
I don't know. How would I know that?
It's Jim.
It's Jim. It had a lot of really good side characters, too.
It really did. With Ray and Lewis.
I love Ray so much.
Yeah, Ray's the best.
Where is he? What's his name? Oh, Jim Cummins. Yeah, he does all the voices.
Yeah, he voices all kinds of stuff. But nobody in this movie is a really big, big star that's a main character.
I mean, Keith David plays Dr. He's, like, in literally everything.
He is in literally everything, but he's never the star of anything.
And he has the best voice.
I play Dr. Facilier, and he's a schemer. He's a conjurer and a sorcerer of sorts.
And
I got friends on the other side.
Yeah. I mean, he narrated that Ken Burns World War II documentary thing that we love so much. He doesn't do the whole thing. I mean, there's some Tom Hanks, there's some other, but he does the main meat of it, and it's so good.
I forgot about that, actually. Yeah. I just was thinking about the That's Something About Mary movie. He's like the dad in that.
He's the stepdad, and he's in Armageddon as like a general.
Oh, and then two of your favorite movies, Roadhouse and Men at Work. He's apparently in those, but I haven't seen those, so I can't speak to that.
He is in those. That's right. That's hilarious.
But he literally has over 350 acting credits on IMDb.
Well, and a lot of those are voice acting credits.
I know, but he's...
That's what he's known for, is that velvety smooth voice.
Yeah, because... Okay, so he's in Gargoyles, the cartoon I watched forever as a kid.
Yeah, he is in Gargoyles. That's exactly right.
Just gotta point that out.
Good point.
We are defenders of the night. We are Gargoyles.
Our main gal, though, Anika Nani Rose, she hasn't really done a ton of notable stuff that I could really see.
No, she had a fairly big part in Dreamgirls.
Excuse me?
Please, princess. It will make me human again.
Just one kiss.
But other than that, it seems like she just does a lot of TV and indie movies, and that's cool.
Her voice was good, though. I thought she was great.
She sounded really good. Her singing voice is very good.
No, really, really good.
The Bruno Campos guy, who was the Prince Naveen, he hasn't really done anything.
No, he's literally just on TV.
Yeah. This was maybe twice.
Yeah, this is his big break.
Yeah.
I thought that I had recognized the guy who voiced Lewis, Michael Leon Worley, more, but he literally just does a bunch of kid stuff.
Like, yeah, just a bunch of voice acting.
All of the Hotel Transylvania series. He's in Madagascar. Maybe I recognize him from Madagascar. I don't remember, but he does a lot of voices.
Yeah, he does.
Why, the Bayou's the best jazz school in the world. All the greats play the riverboats. Oh, Lewis, give anything to be up there jamming with the big boys.
And then the guy who does Ray, his big thing for voices, I just gotta point out, he's Winnie the Pooh.
And Pete from, like, Goof Troop, but he does the modern...
We're the Goof Troop!
Yeah, and all of the...
Mickey things?
Yeah, the modern ones. Yeah. Does a lot of voices.
Like, he's got a lot of range. And then we can just shout out, Oprah was the mom, and John Goodman was the dad.
Oh, Big Daddy.
Big Daddy. It just seems so true to life, like,
well,
that
he lives,
whole relationship.
He has a house in New Orleans.
Oh, great.
But, no, he was really great in his kind of small part.
Wait, hang on a second. Do you think any guy who's fat and rich doesn't have a house in New Orleans?
I mean, do you think anybody who's not rich doesn't have a house in New Orleans?
I'm just saying. Especially fat people, though, because it's the food mecca of our great earth.
I literally want to go back to New Orleans now so bad.
Yeah.
just to eat all the food.
Yeah.
The one guy I was surprised that he just sounds familiar, I guess, is the guy who played Lawrence, the Peter Bartlett guy. He's not really in anything, but he sounded really familiar.
Yeah, but he just sounds like some British guy. It was, you know, whatever. Do you have any fun facts, Kat?
I had a couple. I found a few. There were a lot of facts. I kind of had to sift through them.
There were a lot of facts. Very few were fun. Very few.
Jennifer Hudson, Alicia Keys, and Tyra Banks were all considered for the role of Tiana, and Alicia Keys and Tyra Banks were soliciting Disney to get this part. Like, especially,
I couldn't imagine this.
Alicia
thing, Tyra
Keys
Banks.
Was, like, calling them up, like, yo, you want my services?
They probably should have picked Alicia Keys.
I think the girl they picked...
No, she's fine. She but, did I mean, a really Alicia good job. Keys would be, like... a next level kind of thing, I think.
I disagree. I think I liked the Anika Nani Rose lady. I think she was really good.
I do too. I'm not saying that she wasn't. This is the first since Aladdin to get two Best Song nominations.
And I had that same one, and it wasn't for the two songs that I thought it was going to be for.
Oh, I didn't even see what songs
they
were.
So it was for the Down in New Orleans.
Okay.
And the Almost There song. I thought it was going to be the Dig a Little Deeper song. That was my favorite song in the movie.
Well, see, the thing is, they were all good, so it's kind of tough to be like, oh, blah, blah, blah. One of them won, I assume, right?
I actually didn't look at that part.
That's hilarious.
Hold on. I need to know now. Just a second. And that was a stacked Oscar year.
When I see an elephant fly.
No, it was a song from that movie Crazy Heart.
I've never heard of that.
That's that movie with Jeff Bridges. It's like a, I think it's like a country music movie or something.
Weird.
But
down country,
the weird kind
sounds terrible.
Yeah, it didn't even win Best Animated Movie.
What?
Up did. They came out the same year.
Oh, well.
I do love Up, but I don't know. I really like this.
I do too, but there are cracks in this movie.
There are, I guess, a few things maybe that I would change, but I still just, it's a fun movie. It's a very fun movie.
It's fucking long.
Is it? It's only an hour and 37 minutes. I guess that is long for an animated movie, isn't it?
I thought it was more like an hour and 49 minutes or something, wasn't it?
Hour and 38 minutes.
Well, okay. That seemed a little long, but maybe that's the cracks in the story it has.
There are a few parts that are a little long, but...
So let's get into it.
Let's hop right in.
Hop right in, like a little frog.
First, I just want to say, I've seen this movie once before, but I didn't really remember very much about it, watching it. Like, I remembered that she wanted a restaurant, and that they get turned into frogs, and that was about it.
I knew that it was a princess and a frog, that was all.
Really? You're so observant.
Yeah, yeah.
God, my head is so smiling. In the Southland, there's a city
way down on the river. So we open up little girls, little Tiana, little Charlotte, little Lottie, whatever you want to call her, getting told a story. And you basically take away that Tiana would never kiss a frog, and the chunky little blonde girl would put anything in her mouth.
Yeah, because she just wants to be a princess. Yeah. She is a princess.
And then we fast forward Tiana going home, and she's learning about the gift of food from her dad, who's been working all day, and she was working all day with her mom. And it's the 1910s.
Yeah, I think it said 1912 on the newspaper.
Well, it said Wilson wins.
Oh, okay.
That's how I knew. I just knew Woodrow Wilson came in the teens. So.
I just read in the facts. It said the newspaper said 1912.
Because it's just like pre-World War I.
Right. Her dad wants to open a restaurant, and so it fast forwards and...
To her being a... This is unclear, so she's like a late teens?
Early 20s? I'm gonna guess that it's like early
20s. Yeah, because she was living alone.
It wasn't clear, but like, everyone has given her a hard time about how she works so much, and, you know, she never has any fun, and I feel like just it was establishing that she'd been doing that for a long time.
Yeah, I think early 20s is probably right. Yeah. Because she's saving her money for a restaurant. She has a bunch of coffee cans full of dough, all of her tips.
And it's an exciting day in New Orleans. The song is playing down in New Orleans, and Prince Naveen is arriving on a boat, and there's people everywhere, and she's going to her other job, and she's just a rock star waitress, and Charlotte Lottie is way too excited for the prince to come. Because we get this diner scene where her dad is trying to talk, and she just keeps interrupting him and shoving his face full of beignets, and it's just fantastic.
Yeah, it's very funny. It's a very cool scene. Tia, 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 did you hear the news?
Tell her. Oh, tell her, Big Daddy. Oh, yeah, Prince Naveen.
Prince Naveen of Meldonia is coming to New Orleans.
And she just gives Tiana a huge stack of money to make these man-catching beignets for her Mardi Gras party that she has going on. And that basically gives Tiana enough money to...
open a restaurant.
To buy the building for her restaurant.
Yeah. Which is weird, because you don't usually buy a building, you usually lease it, but whatever.
She has big dreams.
Yeah, big dreams. And if you do have big dreams, you should own it.
Well, and they kind of hinted at that was the building her dad wanted to buy for the restaurant.
Oh. No, it wasn't a hint. They hit us over the head with it.
I don't remember. Because her mom shows up when she gets the keys and has this big gumbo pot that was her dad's.
And the place is just an absolute dump.
Yeah. And her mom's like, you should settle down and have some love. I want some grandkids.
And they're like singing the Almost There song, cleaning up the place.
This is a good song.
It is a good song. Just doing what I do. Look out, boys, I'm coming through. And then we get a scene with the jazzy prince being just a player. But oh no, he gets mixed up with the Shadow Man, the Dr. Voodoo.
Yeah, and he has his little henchman and is, you know, carrying all his stuff. And he's like, sir, this is not good. This guy's sketchy. We should go. And he's like, no, it's great. Da-da-da-da. Like, I love everything. I'm so oblivious and stupid, which totally tracks.
Well, yeah, as a dumb, rich, formerly rich, but... just, you know, spoiled prince. Yeah, of course.
Because his parents cut him off because he keeps partying and spending all their money.
Yeah, he's a leech. So the doctor does his voodoo about him having a bunch of grain and turns him into a frog. And what we don't see in the scene is that Lawrence gets turned into Prince Naveen.
And then we're at the party all of a sudden, the Mardi Gras party, right?
Yep.
And they tell Tiana that someone outbid her on the building.
Which was one of the worst plot points of this movie. It was unnecessary.
Well, but that was the thing, is because she needed more money to get the building. Like,
yeah, I could have done without all that. I could have done without that whole jiving back and forth with Charlotte, and I didn't need it. But
well, because here's the thing. If Charlotte was really a good friend, she would just give her the money.
Well, no, I don't think that's true. You shouldn't be giving your friends money just because.
No, but I mean, like, she could have given it to her as a loan. Like, she could have invested.
No. You don't want to play with your friends and money.
Correct, sir.
She falls all over herself somehow, or something happens where she, like, knocks the beignet thing, and then Charlotte's like, oh, gosh, let's get you cleaned up and put in this fancy dress.
Yeah, and she sings the second Almost There song.
The sad one.
Yeah, and then she meets the frog in the bedroom where she got dressed, because Charlotte was like, I'm out of here, I gotta go play some...
Right, because Prince Naveen, in quotes, is there, and she's been dancing with him, but we don't know that it's not really Prince Naveen at this point.
Right, so the frog's up there and convinces Tiana to kiss him.
Yeah, it's actually really funny when she's trying to psych herself up to do it. She's like, ah, this is gross.
Yeah. But she does it, and then she turns into a frog, too.
Yeah, which, it doesn't really explain why she gets turned into a frog.
Because she's not a princess.
I know, but why would that turn her into a frog?
I guess that's just the voodoo.
It's just how the magic works. And then there's a whole wacky scene where they're, you know, they fall down through all the food. Everyone's trying to stab them and get them, and they're trying to escape, and they end up going on some balloons. And
it's like, really funny in these movies how, like, just an animal at a party really makes people flip out. God,
I mean, really, they're just, they can't handle it.
I mean, it's New Orleans. They have
everything.
Oh, no, they have those nutria rats that are as big as a dog. Come on.
Nobody's going to care about
a couple of frogs. Like,
yeah, right. No, that is true. But it was also, like, early 1900s, so maybe they weren't as...
Oh, you mean they would have just shot? Definitely would have cared about the frog. They might have tried to catch it to eat it.
And they end up out in the bayou because they got floated... They floated away on these balloons.
And the balloons popped and they fell into the bayou. Or the swamp, as I like to say. And this is where we find out that Larry is Prince Naveen.
You mean Lawrence?
Lawrence. Well, they call him Larry a couple times,
they do?
Too.
Yeah. Okay. This movie did that with a couple people. It said one name and then called them a different name.
Yeah, there was some... That's what I'm saying. This movie is great, but there are some glaring imperfections. Repeat. It's like, wait, oh, man, come on.
Yeah. They are, like, trying to run from these gators in the bayou.
And they get up into a stump. They stay the night. And as they're leaving the stump, they get another gator behind him because he's singing. And he's playing a little made-up guitar thing.
Oh, yeah.
And that's where we meet Louie.
Hey, guys, I just had me a crazy idea. What if I asked Mama Odie to turn me human?
The big,
I really love him.
Trumpet playing gator, and he's the best.
He's really funny, and so when he's telling them the story about when he's like, I tried to go play with the humans, and he jumps off the boat, and then they just shoot him with the guns.
We both started busting out laughing because that was a really funny gag in that whole thing. He's like,
eh. Yeah, no, that Lewis was very funny. He was a really good character.
Yeah.
And he's like, what, Louis Armstrong in alligator form?
Yeah.
And then they sing a song about what they're going to do when they're human.
Yeah. And they all have three very different paths. Prince Naveen's going to fuck all the bitches. Tiana's going to work really hard. And Louis just wants to blow his horn.
He just wants to play instruments. He's a good guy.
Yeah. He's just a musical dude.
Yeah, because he's thinking, oh, God, it's like Wizard of Oz. Maybe they'll turn me into a human.
And then we get a weird scene with Charlotte and quote-unquote Prince Naveen, where he's turning back into Larry.
Because the blood is going away. Because he's very kind of dark, actually. He's wearing this necklace filled with Naveen's blood, and that's why he's able to be him or something.
Right.
And this necklace is like, Dr. Felsier is like, don't drop the necklace. Like, be careful with it.
Right. But but Charlotte's too wrapped up in the fact that she's going to get married to really notice what's going on. She just runs away.
Yeah, like as the guy's butt is exploding.
Yeah.
And all these... his parts are, you know, we're going to have ourselves a Mardi Gras wedding. And then Dr. Felser's like, no, the blood.
The blood. And they release the shadows because he has to make a separate deal with the, or is that later? Oh,
that's a little bit later. But either way, he does in a later scene, he basically convinces all the spirits that, oh, if you help me get the frog back, I'm going to kill Big Daddy. And then we're going to own New Orleans and all this other stuff. Oh, because back in the bayou, that's where we meet Ray.
Yeah, because somehow Naveen and Tiana are, like, reflexively eating bugs, and it grosses Tiana out.
Yeah, okay.
And they completely lock themselves up in their tongues.
That's funny.
They wrap the shit out of themselves. And Ray shows up. He's a little firefly.
A Cajun firefly.
And he unties them as Louie's looking for a sharp stick to untie.
And he's like, you guys are going the wrong way to see this bayou voodoo lady. You need to go.
Madame Odie. Mama Odie.
Yeah. So Mama he gets Odie. All of his firefly family to help him, which I love this part,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, I do, too. It's great. Anything with all the fireflies is pretty great.
Going down the bayou. We're gonna dig it down. We're gonna dig it down. We're gonna dig all the way.
Going down the bayou. Going down the bayou. And one of the only non-Randy Newman songs.
It was good, though. I enjoyed it.
It was a good song.
And as when he's like, Grandma, your light's out. He's introducing all his family. So that's when the evil spirit thing with Dr. Felsier is right after this.
Yeah, yeah.
Because then when they go back to the bayou, this is where there's all these Cajun hillbillies who capture the frogs. And there's like a wacky scene.
The wacky frog, hillbilly frog bash-up.
And they basically Three Stooge them. And they, it's like kind of a throwaway scene.
No, it's not a throwaway, but it is actually, you know, it is throwaway.
Like, I could have kind of done without this scene.
Yeah, okay, hang on.
Like, I would have rather had a scene with Charlotte and Lawrence being ridiculous in town. Like, her dress shopping or something, and him trying to, like, hide his face. It would have been really funny.
His whole body?
Yeah. I just got stung by a bunch of mosquitoes. One of my other fun facts that I didn't share was that the reason that the guy who voices Ray, the voice guy, part of the reason they hired him is because he actually lived in New Orleans for a while, so he could do the Cajun voice really well.
He did the Cajun voice really, really well.
Yeah, it was great.
I do enjoy the Cajun accent.
I know. And after the hillbillies, there's a scene where Tiana makes this swamp gumbo because they're all hungry.
Right, and she teaches Naveen how to work. He has to mince mushrooms. It's like, I've never done anything like this before.
Everything's done for you. And they kind of start bonding a little bit. You can see, oh, I see where this is going. And we meet Ray is in love with a star, but he doesn't think it's a star. He thinks it's another firefly named Evangeline, and it's really sweet. And
there's a song with it. And
kind of the cutest part of this
movie.
And
that's one of the other fun facts is that that star is the planet Venus.
There you go. No, I thought that was a very sweet song, actually. He's singing how much he loves her, and then they start dancing, and she's like, I can't dance.
If I can mince, you can dance.
Yep, and there's frog dancing, and then all of a sudden the demons come, but then the old lady...
Yeah, Mama Odie saves him.
Yeah.
She, like, shoots the shadows with her magical club.
And she takes him back to her house, and she just is
flamboyant.
Just whack-a-doodle to the nth degree. She can't see anything. She keeps throwing stuff away, running into stuff. She's all over the place.
Good to see you again, Ray. How's your grandmama?
Oh, she's fine. Got in little trouble for flashing the neighbors again.
Ooh, I like that gal's funk.
Yeah, but once Tiana fixes her gumbo, she helps them out.
Yeah, and they're like, we just need to be human. She's like, no, you got to look within yourself. And she starts singing the song, which I think might be my favorite song.
The Dig Deeper song.
Yeah, I really do.
Dig a little deeper.
It's like just happy, like, Southern church music or something. I don't know.
It kind of is.
It's like gospel music. It's really fun.
Yeah, yeah.
It's really good. Oh, and so there is a really funny part, too, when she's, like, talking to them about what they need, and Tiana's like, blah, blah, blah. She says, hush up and look at the gumbo. Because her, like, magic thing is, like, the gumbo pot.
And during that song, Naveen realizes what he wants. He wants Tiana.
Yeah, he loves her.
But Tiana still is a little lost. She doesn't quite get what she needs or what she wants. She's still a little lost.
Yeah, because he's just, no, I just need to work harder and dig deeper. And she's like, no, you haven't gotten it yet.
You don't get it.
I don't get it.
They get onto a riverboat after this.
Oh,
because Louie runs into a bunch of musicians in costume.
Oh, and they think he's in a costume.
They think he's in a costume, so he gets to play with the band on the boat the whole way.
Yeah, they're like, sweet costume. But they're going back to New Orleans because technically
Charlotte is a princess
until midnight because her dad is the king in the Mardi Gras parade.
Right.
So she's technically a princess.
So Naveen needs to get a kiss from Charlotte. Meanwhile, he sets up this date with Tiana where he's going to propose to her. He like makes a little ring out of a pearl.
And he's like, I'll get three jobs. I'm gonna help her.
And he tells Ray all about it and tells Ray, hey, don't tell her, you know. Even though one of my favorite part about that is when he thinks that Ray is going after Evangeline and he's biting.
Oh, when Ray thinks that Naveen, he's like, so funny. It is really funny. Yeah. Oh, and his little butt gets all red, like, it's fantastic, it's great.
But he doesn't want to, like, crush her dream.
Oh, because she tells him that, I need to come up with the rest of the money.
Right.
So he knows, I have to marry Charlotte so that I can give her the money.
Yeah.
And then, he, like, leaves, and then he gets captured by the spirits again.
Yeah, he gets captured by the spirits. They get off the boat going into New Orleans, and she sees Prince Naveen getting married to Charlotte.
Right, because Ray had just told her.
Right, and then she runs away stupidly, even though Ray's like, no, it's not real.
And she's really mean to Ray. She's like, Evangeline is just a star. Like, fuck off. Like, she's not real.
And he's like, I know you're just saying that out of a broken heart.
It's horrible.
So then there's, like, kind of a lot of nonsense.
Well, what happens is, like, Ray, they somehow figure out, they get Naveen out of the box, and then they get the necklace, and Ray gets the necklace, and, you know, the spirits and Dr. Fauci, what is his name?
Just call him Dr. Fauci.
You know, they're all chasing him, and he's, like, coming to Tiana, he's like, And it's really horrible, because he's steps on Ray, and I, like, terrible. Audibly gasped.
And we all thought he died right there. I just thought he was dead.
Yeah, because Lewis comes up, and he's like, oh, no, Ray. And I was like, oh, my God, he's dead. It's so sad. Oh, there's, like, a showdown between Tiana and...
And the doctor.
The doctor, because he gives her this fake vision of what her...
Well, yeah, he's able to, like, blow visions onto people, and he's trying to trick her.
And she almost falls for it.
Well, and he does get the talisman for a second, but our little froggy friend helps.
She is able to smash it, and then all the spirits come out, because they're taking him, and they're singing some other song.
Yeah, and they take out Doctor... No, it's the same song that he was singing earlier.
Is it?
Yeah. It's the same part of that same dark song.
Okay.
So they eat him up and he's gone. So now they gotta go convince Charlotte.
Oh, yeah.
To kiss him.
But it's already midnight. As they're confessing their love, they couldn't wait to do that till after.
And Charlotte's like, I love you. I love you so much, I'll do it anyways. And it's like, bong, and the kisses don't work.
And so then they say, that's fine, we're going to stay together. And they find out that Ray died, so they take
frogs. They didn't find out Ray died. Ray died in front of them. He's like, I love you. I love that for you guys being frogs.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. And then they take him back to the swamp and have a little, like...
swamp funeral with all the other fireflies. Very sweet.
It's very sad. Yeah. And he becomes a star.
Yeah, right next to Evangeline.
You're feeling better, Ocho.
There's a new star in the sky tonight, everybody.
Definitely got a little misty in there. It was very sweet.
So then they're getting married on the bayou by Mama Odie.
As frogs.
And as soon as they kiss, they turn human.
Technically, when they got married, then that and she was a princess.
Yeah, they made her a princess, so there you go.
Yep, and then they go back, they're like, by swamp, and they get their restaurant, and it's all good.
Yeah, because clearly his parents, who were pictured in the second wedding scene, they probably kicked in.
Well, they saw, he's being responsible,
wasn't permanently cut off, he was just cut off until he got his shit together.
Yeah, they're like, you're responsible now. And they have their restaurant, everything's great, everything's happy, and there's a weird little throwaway bit where Charlotte's, like, dancing with Naveen's 6-year-old brother, and she's like,
I can wait.
I've waited this long. Ew.
She needs to be royal.
She just gotta be, but yeah.
Yeah.
And it's very
happy. And Louis is the band leader in her restaurant. Yeah. So he didn't get to turn human, but he's still
a
horn playing gator.
When they were playing, all the people that were playing with him were kind of like,
Yeah, like leaned away from him, like, oh my god, this big fat alligator.
Yeah. And that's the end of the movie.
That is the end of the movie, but not the end of the podcast.
No, sorry.
So for songs and music, I mean,
oh my God, so many.
Do you want me to go through the list?
Sure.
There's I Never Knew I Needed You.
Oh, that was the one that played in the credits.
Yep.
Which actually wasn't horrible
either.
Opening
credits.
Yeah.
Down in New Orleans. Almost There, Friends on the Other Side, which that's what played at the end as well. When We Are Human, Gonna Take You There.
My Belle Evangeline.
My Belle Evangeline. Dig Deeper, Dipper Mouth Blues, and Cajun Love Song.
Yeah, Dig a Little Deeper is my favorite song from the movie, I think. But I also really like the Friends on the Other Side bit, too.
Yeah, I like Friends on the Other Side. I like Down in New Orleans.
Down in New Orleans. It's all good. Like, they're all really good songs.
They're all good songs.
And it definitely felt very, like you said, American. It definitely felt like a very American New Orleans. Like, I want to go back to New Orleans now really bad.
Yeah. I mean, and that to me was the key to this movie is this was, like, a very American Disney movie.
Yeah.
Which we don't often get or very rarely get.
No.
So, that, to me, gave it a lot of plus points. I was like, ooh, yeah, Merca.
Yeah.
and there's probably nothing, even though there's a lot of French influence on New Orleans is one of the most American places because it's just so weird and crazy.
It's just so...
God, and they invented jazz there, like, which is the most American thing in the world. Like, it's just...
Well, yeah, because that's what Naveen was obsessed with jazz at the beginning of the movies. Oh, this is where it was founded, like, da-da-da-da-da. And that made... why he wanted to go there, because he was obsessed. Kind of seeing all the pretty houses at the very beginning of the movie, I was like, ugh, ugh.
Yeah. So for characters, I mean, the obvious VIPs are Ray and Lewis. Like,
I love Ray so much. And
Ray
was
such a great character.
I was legitimately sad when he died. Like, I was, like, definitely holding back tears.
Although I'm glad they killed the character in this movie. That was very... Yeah.
Well, and it was perfect because he ends up as a star next to Evangeline.
Well, no, I know. But, I mean, it's just good when they give you that element of sadness for somebody who was just the best.
He's just too good for this world.
Yeah, he was too good for this world. It's a good way to put it.
Oh, and Mama What's-Her-Face. I love her, too.
Mama Odie?
Yes,
yeah, Mama Odie is great. And like I said, Lewis. Like, Lewis is the comedic engine of the middle of the movie.
Ugh, Charlotte.
When he gets all those things stuck in him that Ray has to get out of him.
Oh, yeah, I forgot about
it's
that.
It's so funny. He's such a little baby about it. He's like, oh!
Charlotte was a really good character, too.
Yeah, well...
Are you serious? Oh, there's so much to play. I'm in the guest list, the dress, the music, the flowers, the shoes. We're gonna have ourselves a Mardi Gras. Oh, Tia, honey, did you see the way he danced with me? A marriage proposal can't be far behind. Thank you, Evening Star. You know, I was starting to think that wishing on stars was just for babies and crazy people.
Shouts to Lottie.
She's just so funny. And I mean, the villain was really good.
They really just needed to give him a singular name. And that would have, like, if they would have just given him a name, like, he's Drake.
Yeah.
Yeah, that would have been great.
And I mean, Naveen and Tiana were good too. But it's just...
Naveen, actually, I gotta say, Naveen is a net zero.
He was...
But Tiana's a very good character, but Naveen was the weakest character in the story.
Yeah, I would agree with that 100%. Yeah. But yeah, Tiana's a really good character, and she's definitely, like, a really good, like, as far as Disney princesses go, she's a really underrated Disney princess.
Absolutely. I had no idea.
Yeah, she's fantastic.
Oh, yeah, the princess of hard work. Yeah. I mean, come on.
God, what a horrible role model. Yeah. I don't want my daughter to be like that. Jeez, she all she wants to do is work hard.
Yeah, yeah. And keep working even though she's, like, rich and famous or whatever.
God, what a bitch.
Yeah. And the cinematography was beautiful.
So, you know what's interesting? This movie, to me, the animation looked like a hybrid of Treasure Planet and Little Mermaid.
It really did. It really did.
The animation was very similar to Treasure Planet.
Even though it was a little better.
It was a little better, but then some of the scene, like, the way the scenes were oriented reminded me of Little Mermaid.
Like, the Firefly scene in this movie is beautiful. It's very beautiful.
Oh, and actually... the scene where they're in the Mama, I can never remember her name. What is her name again? The blind lady?
Mama Odie.
Mama Odie's house, and all the bottles are everywhere, and she's singing the song. Like, I really like that scene.
Like when she throws something into one of the bottles and breaks.
Yeah, where just all the different colors are everywhere. Yeah. I really enjoyed that scene a lot, too.
Yeah. So did I. So, I think we both, for our Moochie moments, was Lottie in the cafe.
That's pretty good.
What did you put down? That was mine.
I
don't think there was anything better than that.
That's pretty fantastic. I really did.
Like, if you're going to remember something hilarious and weird about this movie.
Just that when she just cannot control her excitement, her dad is trying to talk, and she's just like, tell a big daddy. It was pretty good. For me, my biggest surprise and also I guess a disappointment is I'm just really surprised this honestly doesn't get the same kind of positive credit that like Moana and Tangled do for movies that came out around the same era.
It doesn't get any pop, that's for sure.
And it's kind of unfortunate because it is an enjoyable, fun movie that I feel should get more credit than it does.
That's fair. I just thought it was a little bit long. There were some scenes that went on too long. It just could have used a little tightening up, and I thought it would have been much, much better.
No, I agree, and that's wise, because the story doesn't move as fast as some of those other movies, so that's probably why. But the songs are so good, and it's just such a fun movie.
So, the remake thing, obviously not. I would just tighten it up, make a little cut.
No, I mean, you could do a sequel, though. You could do What's-His-Face Gets Resurrected somehow.
Like, oh, no, you could just do Prince actually was himself, cheats on her, and runs away, and now she has to do something else.
Oh my god. No, there's no cheating in Disney movies. What's wrong
with you?
I'm just saying
the obvious evolution of Disney in total. Just obvious evolution.
He had to dig a little deeper.
Yeah, that's right, exactly. I mean, that's all he talks about most of the movie until he gets, like, one boner over Tiana, and then it's over, and it's like, let's go back to this guy's true nature.
Frog boner.
Yeah.
Sick. It's mucus.
That's what they all say.
Final thoughts?
It's a great movie. Who wouldn't like this movie?
Yeah, it's fun.
What's wrong with you if you don't like this
movie? It's really cute, and it's a fun, cute movie. I really liked it, and if you feel nothing when Ray gets squished...
You're an asshole.
Yeah, because I audibly gasped. I was like...
It was very surprising. It was very surprising.
It was horrible. I hated it.
Did you get a budget for this movie, Kat?
I did. So it was $105 million.
To make it.
And cumulatively, they've made $267 million.
Yeah, so this movie was a total flop for them.
I mean, it wasn't a total flop, but it was...
For them.
Compared to some of the other ones, yeah, which is really
Which I just don't understand, other than I think the biggest thing about this is it was right in the dead center of the economic downturn.
Not fun fact. It was
the Great Recession. Like, nobody had money.
This came out the same day that Avatar came out.
Ooh, that's
so
a bummer.
That's really why I think it didn't... It got overshadowed by Avatar.
When you're talking about everybody having no money and Avatar at the same time, that's a bad
thing. The main thing is that Avatar came out.
I don't think so. I think you underestimate how broke everybody was in 2009.
Well, no, I get it, but I'm just saying, like, this doesn't help.
It doesn't help at all.
It's bad.
What do you think the Rotten Tomatoes score for this is, Kat?
I'm going to guess probably in the low 80s somewhere.
So, with critics, it's 85. And with the people, it's 74. Oh, what the fuck is the matter with you?
I mean...
There's 25% of the people that watch this that say this isn't a good movie? Really? 25?
Yeah, I don't know.
Or 26? That's... no, that smacks of something else.
Yeah, it's...
But, yeah. So, if you were to rate this movie, what would you give the rating?
So, I really enjoyed this movie. I really did. It's not going to be in my top movies, just because of the things we already talked about. It's a little long, but it's just... Oh, it's a fun movie. So, I gave it an 83%.
Ooh!
8.3 out of 10 beignets.
So, not far off from me, I gave it 84.
Yeah.
It's a good movie, but it's not the best movie.
No, but it's just, would watch again.
Yeah, would watch again, would never complain. If my kids like this movie, I would never have a problem with it.
I would be proud if my kids like this movie.
Yeah. Don't really understand why people don't like this movie.
Oh, God.
All right, it's time for Kat's
it's happening.
Favorite part of the podcast. We get number 183.
What?
mean what?
This is, like, in the range a little bit.
It is definitely in the range.
Oh, stop making that face. I feel like I'm going to throw up right now.
I'm excited. I'm very excited.
Is it Aladdin?
It is not Aladdin.
Okay.
It is number 183 from 1993, Cool Runnings.
Oh.
Yeah! A movie we've both seen many times, probably. I've seen this movie probably 15 times, I would say.
I haven't seen it that many times. I think I've seen it two or three times, but it's been a really, really long time since I've seen it.
It has also been a really long time since I've seen it, but it was one of the favorite movies of my youth. I'm very excited to watch this again. Especially, it seems like we've got a run of Dougie Doug lately.
He just won't leave.
He won't leave us alone. So,
and we started from the worst.
What do you think it's about?
We started from the worst one. Worst Dougie Doug. And then we went to the best Dougie Doug.
Yeah. Started with that darn cat, gave us a good Operation Dumbo drop performance, and now we're going to the best.
Draw a line on your head, it looks like a butt. That's always the line I remember from that movie. I don't know why.
I love John Candy. I love this movie.
I just don't really remember. I just remember, honestly, here's the things that flashed in my head with this movie. I remember they're trying to raise money, and that's where he says, draw a line in your head, it looks like a butt. They keep crashing in Africa or whatever, right? Or in Jamaica.
In Jamaica.
Sorry.
Yep.
Something happens at the end of the movie where their bobsled tips over, and then they have to carry it to the finish line, and everyone, it's very emotional.
Yeah.
That's all I remember.
You got it. It's a great movie.
Literally, that's all I remember.
Fantastic.
And the, feel the rhythm, feel the run. Something, it's bobsled time.
Yeah, you're right. That's when they become themselves and they get good. If you want to like, subscribe.
Leave us a review. If you enjoyed this programming, please leave us a solid 5 stars on your platform of choice. We'd appreciate it.
Send us an email at DisneyOddPod@gmail.com. Yeah, it's great. It's lovely. But in the meantime, this has been Disney Odd Pod.
I'm Kat.
I'm Dee.
Bye! Throat's a little scratchy.
COVID.
I don't have COVID.
COVID kitty. Bark, 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 bark.
Meow, meow, meow. Do you want to taste this?
No, I don't.
Why?
I don't want a minty drink.
It's good. I like it, but it's...
healthy?
Like, I definitely can't drive anywhere after drinking this.
Like I could light your breath on fire?
It's very alcohol forward. Stop looking at me, cat. Okay. I think I'm ready, actually.
Okay. I am also ready.